He's locked in a laboratory. Hello, and welcome to another wonderful edition of Corner Conversations. I'm Roger Urban, and I'm here with my best friend, Paul W. Marino.
Good for you. You got it right the first time.
And Paul, with your permission, I will start our show.
Absolutely.
The book I want to review is a booklet that I bought when I was in Gettysburg. It's called A Civil War Handbook by William H. Price. It's a very small book, but it has a terrific amount of very interesting information. He describes the Civil War as the first modern war because it was the first, developed the first practical machine gun. That was the Gatling gun.
Mm-hmm.
The first repeating rifle used in combat. The first use of railroads as a major means of transporting troops and supplies. First mobile siege artillery mounted on rail cars. Extensive use of trenches and field fortifications. Large-scale use of landmines. They call them subterranean shells. Naval mines, or they call them torpedoes at that time. Ironclad ships engaged in combat. Multi-man submarine, which was a complete disaster. Organized and systemic care of the wounded on the battlefield. Now, what famous person was involved with that?
Clara Barton.
Clara Barton. Widespread use of rails for hospital trains. First organized military signal service. And, of course, the first use of signal flags on the battlefield. Military reconnaissance from a manned balloon. The first draft in the United States. The first organized use of Negro troops in combat. First voting in the field for a national election by servicemen. And of course, that was in the North.
Mm-hmm.
And here's one that everybody should remember. The first income tax levied to finance the war. The first photograph taken in combat and the first Medal of Honor awarded an American soldier. It's kind of interesting, I think.
Yeah. Well, you know, a man from North Adams did reconnaissance from a balloon.
You mentioned that in one of our
get-togethers. Yeah, one of the Johnson Guard.
Oh, no kidding. No photograph of it or anything, I would assume?
No.
Too bad, huh?
No, but we have it from the regimental book.
Oh, okay. The author entitled a subsection of the book called Brother Against Brother, and he mentions some very famous people and what their connections were, the first being President Lincoln. He had four brothers-in-law in the Confederate Army, and three of his sisters-in-law were married to Confederate officers. Then there was Jeff Davis. He was the commander-in-chief of the Confederate Army, served in the U.S. Army as a colonel during the Mexican-American War. Both Lincoln and Davis were born in Kentucky, and it was the first state that ever had two of its sons serving as president at the same time, one in the Union and one in the Confederacy. John Tyler. He was the 10th president of the United States, and he was elected to Confederate States Congress in 1862, but died before it convened. His granddaughter unfurled the first flag of the Confederacy, the Stars and Bars, when it was raised over the Confederate capital at Montgomery, Alabama. Then there was the Battle of Lynchburg, Virginia in 1864. There were two presidents involved in the battle. Rutherford B. Hayes and Major William McKinley, U.S. Army. a former vice president, John C. Breckinridge, Confederate Army, and five other Union generals who later rose to be president. These would be Andrew Johnson, Ulysses Grant, James Garfield, Chester A. Arthur, and Benjamin Harrison. The four secretaries of war during the 11 years prior to the Civil War were all from the South, and all four later held office in the Confederate government. And 14 of the 26 Confederate senators had previously served in the United States Congress. Just some very interesting facts, yeah. I thought. Two famous generals, Confederate generals, Robert E. Lee and P.G.T. Beauregard, both ranked second in their graduating classes at West Point, and both officers later returned to hold the position of superintendent of the academy. Lee's appointment to the rank of full colonel in the United States Army was signed by Abraham Lincoln. So when he left the U.S. Army, he was a full colonel. Of course, when he became the leader of the Confederate armies, he was a full general.
Yeah, he was actually planning to side with the Union.
Yes.
But the governor of Virginia asked him to lead the Confederate Army.
Mm-hmm.
And well, it was his state calling, so off he went.
Over a quarter of the West Point graduates who fought during the Civil War fought for the Confederacy. Of the total number of West Pointers who went south, 148 were promoted to the rank of general officer. In all, 313 of the 1,098 officers in the Union Army had joined the Confederacy. That's an amazing fact,
yeah.
I think.
Now, what's the difference between a general officer and a general?
General officer encompasses all the general's ranks, from lieutenant general, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Major general, lieutenant general, the whole thing. So they're all called general officers. If they wore a star on their epaulets, they were a general. Then there was Jeb Stuart. He raided Chambersburg, Pennsylvania in 1862, and he was pursued by federal cavalry under the command of his father-in-law, Brigadier General St. George Cook. Very interesting. As if that wasn't bad enough, there was also a Union general by the name of Jefferson Davis. Only three Confederates ever held the rank of general in the United States Army following the Civil War: Matthew C. Butler, Fitzhugh Lee, and Joe Wheeler. When Lee and Wheeler were promoted to major general in 1901, their commissions were signed by a former Yankee officer, President William McKinley. We know William McKinley.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Very popular president.
Indeed.
And well known in this area.
Then there was George Pickett, famous for Pickett's Charge in Gettysburg.
Didn't he also invent a particular kind of fence?
You think?
The Pickett fence! Continue.
He was appointed to the United States Military Academy from Illinois. And he obtained the appointment at the request of his law partner, Abraham Lincoln. So there were some interesting
connections yeah.
in this thing. The first superintendent of the United States Naval Academy was Commodore Franklin Buchanan. He also commanded the CSS, that's a Confederate state ship, Virginia, which we know as the Merrimack, in its first engagement. On the first ship to surrender under Virginia's guns were Buchanan's brother, and also an officer in the U.S. Navy. Then it mentioned a number of other people that might be familiar to some of us. There was a New England poet, Albert Pike. He served in the Confederate Department of Indian Territory. Then there was General Lew Wallace, the author of Ben-Hur. He served as a Union general at the Battle of Monocacy. And then after the war, he served as governor of New Mexico and minister to Turkey. Then there was an outfit called the Marion Rangers. This was organized in 1861, and it was a gentleman by the name of Samuel Clemens, Mark Twain.
Ah, yes.
He joined as a lieutenant. But he left his Missouri company before it was mustered in a Confederate army, having fired only one hostile shot during the war. Andrew Carnegie, or Carnegie, depending on how you want to pronounce it, he was given the position of superintendent of military railways. Henry DuPont, grandson of the DuPont Industries founder, was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor at the Battle of Cedar Creek in 1864. He had graduated from West Point at the head of his class in 1861, and then went on to serve as United States Senator from Delaware.
Now, that's, you know, as you bring up the name DuPont, mm-hmm. my brother Ralph lives in a house that was built by the DuPonts over in Valley Falls. There was a gunpowder factory there that was owned by the DuPonts, and the DuPonts built a duplicate of DuPont's own house for their manager to live in.
How about that?
And that's the house my brother has.
And what town was that, you said?
Valley Falls, New York.
New York, okay. I don't, for some reason, associate the DuPonts with New York, but I'm wrong.
Yeah, well, it's because of the gunpowder factory.
Yeah, yeah. Wouldn't you like to live in a town that had a gunpowder factory in those days? I don't think so. George Westinghouse served in the Union Army. We know Mr. Westinghouse.
Oh, yes.
He made light bulbs.
Well, he is also credited with designing the modern railroad brake. Mm-hmm. And you will remember that there is a man buried in Hillside who also invented a railroad brake and spent the rest of his life trying to market it. Every railroad he spoke to was very interested, as long as they didn't have to pay for it. And eventually, after his death, his son took his patents to New York City and sold them to George Westinghouse.
Uh-huh. Is this the gentleman that's buried at Hillside?
Yes.
How about that? So we do have a connection there, huh?
Yes, absolutely.
Cornelius Vanderbilt, he gave a ship to the United States Navy, and there were, at the time he did that, there were less than 50 ships in the naval service, which is fascinating. The cruiser, named the Vanderbilt, captured 3 blockade runners during the war and participated in a bombardment and amphibious assault. Ooh, that was one of the first amphibious assaults on Fort Fisher, and there was a movie made about that. Not his portion of it, but the mm-hmm. assault on Fort Fisher. Largely due to the fact that a great number of black Union soldiers fought in that battle. I can't remember the name of the movie, but I think it was Glory, if I'm not mistaken.
That could be.
I think so. And then there was Christopher Kit Carson, who commanded the 1st New Mexico Volunteers, which was a Union outfit, and campaigned against the Comanche, Navajo, and Apache Indians during the Civil War. And I never realized that. He was later promoted to Brigadier General. And then there was a name that I think we all know. In his mid-teens, a gentleman by the name of Jesse James joined the Confederate Raiders, led by William Quantrell. The famous Dead or Alive reward for Jesse in 1862 was issued by an ex-Confederate officer, Governor Thomas T. Crittenden of Missouri. So these are just some of the small factoids I gleaned from this book, which I found absolutely fascinating. Mm-hmm. The connections between some of these men who weren't famous at the time, but later became quite famous. That's all that I got from this, and there may have been more. But it was kind of fascinating to see where their allegiances led them. Not all Northerners served in the Union Army or were. Who loved the Union. Some of them were very prominent in Confederate circles. So if you ever want to read more about the Civil War, try to find this booklet. You may find it at one of the book companies, I don't know, but it was given to me, or I should say I bought it at Gettysburg, Virginia, in their little library. They have a fascinating collection of books.
I'll bet.
Paul, that is all I have.
Well, I have a couple of things for you. I think I may have covered this book before, Board of the Rings, which is the Harvard Lampoon's parody of Lord of the Rings. And some of the things in this are just hysterical. So I'm going to read you essentially 1, 2, 3 paragraphs. Now, if you're familiar with the Lord of the Rings, there is the character of Shelob, a giant spider that lives in a cave at the top of the steps leading up to Cirith Ungol. Ages ago, when the world was young and Sorehead's heart had not yet hardened like stale cheesecake, he had taken a young troll maiden and his wife. Her name was Mazola, called by the elves Blanche, and she married the handsome young witch king over the objections of her parents, who pointed out that Sorehead simply wasn't trollish, and could never provide for her special needs. But the two were young and starry-eyed. The first 100,000 years found the newlyweds still quite happy. They then lived in a converted 3-room dungeon with a view, and while the ambitious hubby studied demonology and business administration at night school, Mazola bore him 9 strapping wraiths. Then came the day when Sorehead learned of the great ring and the many powers it would bring him in his climb to the top. Forgetting all else, he yanked his sons from medical school over his wife's strident objections and dubbed them nostrils. But the first ring war went badly. Sorehead and his ringers barely escaped with their lives. From then on, their marital relations went from bad to worse. Sorehead spent all his time at the witchworks, and Mazola sat home casting evil spells and watching the daytime Malamar serials. She began to put on weight. Then, one day, Sorehead found Mazola and a Malamar repairman in a compromising position and immediately filed divorce proceedings, eventually winning the custody of the 9 nostril. Mazola, now banished to her drab surroundings in the bowels of Saul Herrick, let her hatred grow and fester. Shlob was she now called. For eons she nurtured her pique, obsessively stuffing herself with bonbons, movie magazines, and an occasional spelunker. At first, Sorehead dutifully sent her monthly alimony payments of a dozen or so narc volunteers, but these gifts soon stopped when word got around what a dinner invitation with Sorehead's ex actually entailed. Her gnawing fury knew no bounds. She prowled her lair with murderous intent, eternally cursing the memory of her husband and his derisive Trollac jokes. For ages, her only interest had been revenge, as she brooded in her dark, dark lair. Cutting off her lights had been the last straw.
Now, did Mazola go on to found a Mazola company?
No.
Making oil?
No, she became Shlob.
Oh. That's too bad.
Yeah, a wonderful thing about this is the way they use modern terms and and subvert them completely. Now, I do not know how much time we have left, so I have two short stories.
Okay.
Would you like me to start with the pleasant one, or?
No, I'll leave that one till last.
Okay. You seem to think that all I write about is cannibalism, and nothing could be further from the truth. Now, this story, Win-Win, has a story behind it. Some years ago, when my writer's group still existed and was looking for new members, a man whose name escapes me joined the group, though only briefly. Some opportunity came along that he wanted to pursue, and off he went. But before he left, he told us about an idea he had for a story, and he said that I should be the one to write it. And, well, that's both astounding and a humbling thing to be told. Well, it marinated in my brain for years and years, and finally, this is what I came up with.
Hold on to your seats.
Now, also, I will say there are several nasty words in it, which I will work around. I'll either say expletive or some such thing. Win-win. Henry sat as far to the right as he could without actually getting out of the car. His guide and mentor was disgusting. His name was Walters. Walters was a slob who chewed with his mouth open, slurped his coffee, belched freely, and broke wind as he liked. He smoked like a chimney and talked almost nonstop, bellowing as if Henry was two cars back, a place Henry would have been much happier in. But then he wouldn't have been able to witness what he had come from all the way to from London to see. The Americans, endlessly inventive as they were, had come up with a new deterrent to crime. Its success rate was phenomenal. Crime in American cities had dropped by 80% over the past 2 years. Everything from drunk drivers to drug cartels were vanishing. From the comfortable perspective of the far side of the Atlantic, European police forces watched with amazement and wondered if the new American tactic, whatever it was, would work for them as well. At length, Henry was chosen by Scotland Yard to make the trip across the pond and witness it firsthand. It was a high honor, one in a long line of honorifics and achievements. Like many other detectives, Henry had begun his career as a patrolman, a bobby who pounded a beat. Participating in a series of high-profile arrests and a citation for courage won him the opportunity to work as a detective. He worked his way up through the ranks, working in vice, homicide, and drug enforcement. He'd even done some undercover work that attracted the attention of MI5. Offered a place there, he turned it down. Police work was his passion. And so it was that his superiors tagged him for this special mission. He accepted it with alacrity. If what they were hearing about America was true, it would be a glorious plum to bring the whole story back and spring it on British criminals. At least, that was his original thought. Jammed in a car with this loud, uncouth oaf, he silently wished he'd let the honor go to someone else. Though by the same token, he didn't know anyone on either side of the law that he'd wish this assignment on. Now this is what I'm talking about, Walter shouted. His half-chewed donut spilled out of his mouth and rolled down to the floor, but he was laughing too loud to notice. Gotcha, expletive! He threw a switch, turning on the lights and the siren. The car ahead of them swerved wildly, then pulled over. Walters pulled in behind it and shut the siren off. Wait till you see this. He grabbed a clipboard and a small electronic device and climbed out of the cruiser, an eager grin on his face. Henry got out the other side, putting on his best impassive expression. They approached the car from opposite sides, Walters taking the driver's side. Out of the car, he demanded. The driver complied, shaking like a leaf. He was scared out of his mind. Do you know how fast you were going? No, officer, I'm sure I was doing the limit. You were doing 45. This is a 35 zone. The driver almost fainted. I couldn't have been. The officer laughed. Want to bet? With a sadistic smile, he held up the electronic device. The driver burst into tears and began pleading hysterically. Walters shoved him back against the car and pressed the device to his forehead. Were you speeding? He asked. The driver sobbed out loud, but as the lights flickered over the device's screen, his face went blank. A few moments later, the screen went black and quickly faded to a deep red. The man's mouth dropped open. Yes. Henry watched quizzically. What in the hell was going on here? The driver's face remained blank when the device was withdrawn. A moment later, he blinked several times and shook his head. Then he saw the evil smile on Walter's face as he held out the device so he could see the red screen. It took a moment for it to register, and then he was bawling and begging for mercy. Henry was coming around the car to try to reassure him. The officer thrust his clipboard at the man. Sign here. The man was still gibbering. Walter slapped him hard across the face. Henry gasped in horror. Sign here. With shaking hands, the man signed, then gibbered again. Please, at least let me call my wife. Drawing his gun, Walters grinned. Sure thing. He put the muzzle to the man's forehead and pulled the trigger. The man's head exploded and his body crumpled to the ground. The officer grinned at Henry and walked back to the squad car. Now that's what I'm talking about. He swung down into the car and began writing on the clipboard. For a moment, Henry was tempted to run to the nearest airport and fly back to London on the spot, or just run to anywhere that wasn't near this madman. But then he was first and foremost a police officer, a lifer. He ripped open the door and leaped in. What the bloody hell was that all about? Walters grinned at him. It's what you came here to see, Limey. What are you talking about? Walters held up the device. This is a truther. There's some effing big name for it, but who the hell can remember what it is? Call it a truther. It's something like a lie detector. What it does is it interfaces with the brain, drives out emotion, and forces you to tell the truth. Look. He put the device to Henry's forehead and asked, "Are you an Englishman?" Henry gasped out loud. His anger, his fury were dissipating. He could feel them being pushed aside, along with any other thoughts that didn't have to do with the question he'd been asked. He wanted to ask questions of his own, but they evaporated. Only the one question remained, "Are you an Englishman?" It was a sickening feeling, sickening and horrifying. There was only one thing he could say, and it slipped out of his mouth as if it had a mind of its own. Yes. He didn't feel the device removed. All he felt was his mind coming back, his thoughts and emotions flooding back into his otherwise empty mind. As distorting as it had been to lose them, their return was even worse. It took him several seconds to realize what they were and a few seconds more to order them. He blinked several times and saw that Walters was holding up the device in front of him, its screen a deep red. For a second more, he thought Walters was going to shoot him too. See? You can't say anything but the truth. Walters put the device down and held up the clipboard. Now, this form, he signs, is him waiving his right to a trial. Once he signed this, he gets executed. Bang. But why would he waive his right to a trial? Why would anyone? Money, Walters chuckled. If he wants a trial, he's responsible for all the court costs. Rent on the courtroom, salaries for his attorney, the judge, the prosecutor, the bailiffs, the person that types it all up, even the costs involved in recruiting and taking care of the jury. Anything that costs anything, from the gas it takes to get him to the jail and to court, his rent on his cell, you name it, he's got to pay for it. Henry's head was spinning. My God, that's effing brilliant. So he waives his right to a trial, gets executed on the spot. It makes everybody else pretty damn careful. But to execute someone for speeding? It's the law now, Walter shrugged. Every crime is a capital offense. A kid steals a candy bar, he's still a thief. If it's illegal, you die for it. Henry closed his eyes and breathed deeply, counting to 10. When he opened his eyes, he realized he hadn't accomplished anything. All he knew was had to think of something else for a while. He looked at the clipboard. Walters was ticking off boxes and scrawling initials beside them. What are you doing now? Henry asked. Walters ran his pen down the list. These are the key points the perp has to understand to sign the waiver. By checking them off, I'm saying that I explained them to him. But you didn't! Big deal. Everybody knows what these things say. Besides, the only people that can afford to pay for a trial are stinking rich. That little pissant didn't have a choice. But by checking them off, you're lying. You're committing fraud. Walters laughed. Boy, you so limeys are so full of expletive. This is the New World Order. Get your head out of your ass and get used to it. They pulled three more cars over before going back to the station. Henry didn't bother getting out of the car. Instead, he watched with horror and disbelief as Walters executed two more men and a woman. One was for driving with a broken taillight. The second was for speeding. The woman was the worst. Pulled over for having an outdated stamp on her license plate, she refused to sign the form unless it was explained to her. Walters took her by the throat and half strangled her before she signed. Then he drew his gun and shot her. When he did, Henry opened his door and vomited. When they reached the police station, he was livid with outrage. Captain Thompson, his initial contact, gave him a sympathetic look. By the look on your face, you must have witnessed our new system. Eye-opening, isn't it? That's not all it is, Henry spat back. This officer, this excuse for an officer, is a psychopath. Walters laughed crudely. Calm down, the captain replied soothingly. It's tough to witness for the first few times, but witness hell. This man made his victims sign the waiver without explaining it to them. The captain frowned, swiveling his head to look at Walters, who was starting to type up his report. The captain strolled over and lifted the sheaf of papers. They're initialed, he said. He filled those in after the executions. The captain looked down at Walters, who stared at him with blank eyes. Come on, Cap, who are you going to believe? Me or some dumbass limey? I'll tell you who I believe, Smitty? Another officer walked forward, drawing a device. Walter rolled his eyes. Oh, come on. Smitty pressed the device to Walter's forehead. The sneering face went blank. Did you make your perp sign the waiver without reading it to them? Walter's mouth opened and closed as if he was trying to resist. The lights flashed. His mouth fell open. Yes. The screen glowed red. Smitty pulled the device away. Walters blinked and shook his head. He glanced at the screen, still turned red, and turned venomous eyes on Henry. You expletive limey! Two other officers stepped forward to restrain him. The captain took his gun, and Smitty began reading the waiver. This document is a legally binding waiver. By signing it, you are waiving your right to a trial by jury and are accepting the judgment of the arresting officer. If you desire to plead your case in court, oh, shut the bleep up, Smitty, I know what it says. If you desire to plead your case in court, understand that you will be held responsible for any and all costs that said trial results in. Walters ripped an arm free from one of the officers holding him and grabbed the clipboard. Then he pulled a pen and began ticking things off. I understand that. I understand that. I understand that. Henry watched him, transfixed. He went down the list, signed at the bottom, and threw the clipboard back at Smitty. Smitty turned and looked to the captain, who nodded. Smitty drew his gun, and the three officers marched Walters into a small room. Pausing at the door, Walters turned back and spat toward Henry. I'll see you in hell, expletive. The three officers pulled him into the room and closed the door. A second later, the gun boomed like a cannon. Even with the door closed, Henry could still smell the cordite. Thompson took his arm and led him into his office. Sinking into his chair, the captain regarded him with cool eyes. You happy now? What kind of a question is that? Of course I'm not happy. Well, satisfied then. What are you talking about? The captain grabbed a bottle, poured two fingers of whiskey, and knocked it back. Okay, look. You just got a crooked cop executed. What makes you think you've accomplished anything? Henry gaped at him. What makes me think? I got a psychopath off the streets, didn't I? Thompson poured out two more fingers and swallowed it. Yeah, you got a psychopath off the streets. Congratulations. He poured another two fingers. What are you saying? Plain English, please. Thompson looked at the drink, then sighed and put the glass down. Plain English, huh? Okay, here it is. You got one psychopath off the streets, but only one. Henry started to speak, but Thompson waved his hand at him. What I'm telling you is that psychopaths are all we hire anymore. What? Look, when I started as a cop, we wanted guys who were strong, smart, and moral, who could be taught when to draw a gun and when to fire it, when to not draw a gun and when to draw but not fire it, who'd understand how to get through an arrest without even pulling a weapon, let alone firing one. Most of them are gone now. Since we started using the truthers, we've needed psychopaths. Henry stared at him aghast. It makes sense. Now we need cops that can pull a gun and shoot someone, anyone, in cold blood. Most people can't do that, but psychopaths can. It's killing two birds with one stone. You round up all the psychopaths, then you put them to work for you. They get to kill all they want. They just have to follow a simple, basic procedure. We get a lower crime rate. It's a win-win situation. Henry was staring at him with blank eyes, his mouth hanging open. Thompson heaved a sigh, grabbed another glass, poured two fingers out, and set the glass on the side of the desk nearest Henry. "Here, you look like you need this more than I do."
Right.
Well, my friend's idea was using the truther, that you put it to somebody's head, ask them, "Did you do it?" And they have to answer yes if they did it. And then they got shot on the spot.
Right.
But I'm the one that came up with using the psychopaths.
Okay.
Yes, okay. So I have another story that's, it's not as nasty as that one. And this is all out of my own balding head. Ooh, yeah, more is the pity. Matchless. I was with Joe when it happened, but that doesn't mean I understand it. It was two of those weird things that just happen. Only these two weird things came right on top of each other. Joe never explained any of it. Me and Joe were replacing a fire hydrant on Fifth Street when some clown with long hair walked by. I didn't notice him at first, not until he shouted at us, "You! Hey, you!" We both looked and he was standing there pointing at us. He stormed over to us and started shouting in Joe's face, "What the hell are you doing here?" "Do I know you?" Joe asked. "You're damn right you know me. What are you doing here?" Joe smiled. "I'm sorry, I don't seem to recall you. What's your name?" "Don't you waste my time with nonsense. You tell me what you're doing here, damn it." Joe stopped smiling. "If you'd use your eyes, you'd see I'm replacing a broken fire hydrant." The guy scowled. "I told you not to waste my time. I'm losing patience with you. I think you've mistaken me for someone else." The guy shook his head, making his hair fly. It was pretty hair. On a woman, it would have been called beautiful. And once I focused on him, I saw that even his face was womanish, delicately boned with a creamy complexion. His eyes were brown and deep, though they were sparkling with anger. "No, it's no mistake. Now stop playing games." "Now, look, I'm not playing games. I'm trying to work here." Why don't you just back off? How did you get out of the tumulus?" "The tumulus," I said. "What the hell is a tumulus?" Pardon.
Not me, Louise.
That's right. Now she's going to nag me the next time
That's
I call
correct.
You. Yeah. Drink no, water.
Do that.
I am drinking water. The guy looked me in the eye, and that was enough to shut me up. There was something in those eyes that chilled me to the bone. I don't know what it was, but I just got the notion that if I didn't stay out of this, I'd wind up in a tumulus myself. Whatever the hell a tumulus was. "What's this all about?" Joe demanded. "Who the hell are you?" "Morgan," the guy growled. "Morgan Le Fay." Joe smiled again. "From what I've heard, Morgan Le Fay was a woman. I'm in disguise, just like you." "Just like me. So who am I supposed to be?" The guy smiled, but not pleasantly. More like he had Joe right where he wanted him. "You're Merlin." This was where I called the cops. I didn't know who Merlin was supposed to be or why this clown was pretending to be a woman, pretending she was a man, but I didn't really care either. We had a job to do, and five more after this one was done, and this guy was seriously getting in our way. I stepped into the crowd that was gathering and made my way to the payphone down the street. They said they'd send a squad car. You were sealed in a tumulus and should be there still, the guy was saying. You have no business being out of it, and even less being here pretending to be a public works lackey. Look, pal, Joe sounded bored. I hadn't known him long. From what I'd heard, he had the patience of a saint. But if someone pushed him to boredom, that's when the trouble started. For the last time, my name's not Merlin. It's Merlini, Joseph Allen Merlini. A cheap attempt to disguise your identity, and one that is below even you. I caught Joe's eye and mind putting a handcuff on my wrist behind the weirdo's back. He looked relieved and nodded. I apologize for offending you. I guess I should have checked with you first. It's just that it gets so dull in that tumulus. I needed a break. A break. I'll give you a break. The guy's hair started flowing out, standing on end as if he was full of static electricity. His right hand started coming up. All right, what's going on here? The police had arrived. The guy with the hair spun around, looking startled and offended. I raised my hand. I placed the call, officer. This guy is breaking up our job. The guy turned his cold eyes on me, but only for half a second or so. Then he was talking to the cop, pointing at Joe. This man is an imposter and a fugitive. He thinks I'm Merlin, the magician, Joe said, sounding bored. Really? The cop said. He thinks he's some woman, I chimed in, named Morgan Laffey. Lefay, Joe corrected me. King Arthur's half-sister. Oh, really? The cop said, starting to smile. Lefay scowled at him. Who I am is irrelevant. What matters, the cop interrupted him, is that you move along and let these guys finish their work. I will do no such thing. That man belongs in his tumulus, and I will see him put back in it. That's when the cop grabbed him. Even as he started to struggle, Joe and me waded in and held him while the cop put the cuffs on him. What do you say we go for a nice ride? The cop asked, opening the door of the squad car. This isn't done, Merlin, the guy shouted. It isn't done, and you know it. The cop closed the door on him. Me, Joe, and the cop all drew a deep breath. The cop stayed a few minutes more, getting some information from us and dispersing the crowd, then got in the car and drove off, his passenger still bellyaching. Joe sighed, took out a cigarette and stuck it between his lips. Well, wasn't that an adventure? He asked. He closed his mouth and breathed in. The tip of the cigarette flared and glowed red. I stared at him with my mouth hanging open. He blew out some smoke and said, what? And that's that story.
Okay. Now.
Go ahead.
What in heaven's name was the tumulus?
Well, a tumulus is a burial mound. And when it was time for it to happen, you see, Merlin aged backwards. So he was an old man in Arthur's time, but he grew younger and younger and younger. And one day he fell in love with a young woman whose name escapes me, and he taught her various magical things. And one day they went into a tumulus where he had a feast ready, and after the feast she went outside and cast a spell that sealed him in the tumulus.
Okay. Macabre.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Well, Strange.
Yes.
Interesting. It's good.
That's one thing about me. I do have a strange imagination.
Yes, you do. You do.
And I'm darn proud of it.
Oh, my.
So we have 7.5 minutes left. Goodness. I don't think I have time to read anything else.
Goodness gracious.
But next time, I want to read Tom's Thumb, which I'm sure you'll find interesting.
Okay.
If you don't want to wait until next time, the next show, you feel free to look it up. Go to my website, to the fiction page, and you'll find a reference. Well, you'll find links to all of my stories, including my novel and my unfinished novel, Donor.
What was your novel, Paul?
The novel was Faith.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
Excuse me, Faith. It's a story of religious faith from a very uncomfortable perspective.
Uh-huh.
When I first had the idea, oh, nearly 50 years ago, the story was much bloodier than it is now. But when the idea recurred to me, when it had been marinating up here for for a few decades, I realized that it had to be about faith. Because if it wasn't about faith, it wasn't about anything. And it's about a young man, 18 years old. He has been raised since the age of 2 in a monastery, not a Christian monastery. This is an entirely fictitious religion. But he has been raised in a monastery, and on his 18th birthday, the high priest comes to the monastery, and it reminds him that he only has a month to live, because he is going to be taken to the main temple, which is a long day's drive away, and there he is going to be sacrificed.
Okay.
Yeah, I read the beginning of it at an open mic when my mother was still alive, and when we went to dinner afterward. So, what made you decide to write a story about a monk? And I dithered for a while because, for various reasons, I really didn't want to discuss it with her. But then I came up with a perfect answer. I told her what it was about. He's going to be a human sacrifice. Ah! And she didn't want to talk about it anymore.
Okay, that's understandable.
Yeah. So every time she came upstairs and saw me at the computer, she asked me what I was doing. And I'd tell her, I'm working on my story. Didn't want to hear anymore. But I knew I was really onto something with this, partly because I was constantly getting ideas. I started carrying 2 reporters' notebooks around with me. And if I was at work and I got an idea, as soon as I could, I would write it down in as much detail as I could. If I was driving down to Pittsfield to go to my writer's group, I'd get an idea, and as soon as I got into Applebee's, I'd start writing. And when I got home, I would get out my notebooks and start writing, you know, fleshing those things mm-hmm. out. The other way I knew I was onto something was the buttons of my writer's group were getting pushed left and right. They were seeing things in the story that were not there. You know, they were horrified by it, but they still wanted to hear what was happening.
Are you still a member of a writer's group?
No.
No.
No, the writer's group broke up some years ago, and it's never got back together.
Have you ever made any attempt to get these things published?
No. No. When I first joined the writers group, I was working on a group of stories about the fictitious town of Webster, New Hampshire, which is not to be confused with the actual Webster, New Hampshire, which is a city west of Concord. My Webster, New Hampshire is a small farming community down near Nashua. And it's the kind of place where nothing ever happens, but practically everything has happened there. The first manned aircraft was launched from there. A farmer perfected a method of dehydrating water. Just add water, and you've got more water. Another farmer designed a house that functioned like a black hole. Sunlight could get in, but it couldn't get out again. Let me see here. Oh, yes, there was a scientist with an active interest in sex, not in the act of sex, but in the mechanics of it, who perfected a method of breeding pencils.
All right.
And so what I had in mind was a book to be titled Pencils and Other Stories of Webster, New Hampshire. You know, and for some reason, all of these things have to fail. In fact, I have a story here that I was trying to write for that, but it apparently wasn't ready to be written. And then a couple of years ago, it hit me, and so I wrote it. It's titled Naomi, and I will read that here sometime.
Okay.
Maybe next week.
God willing, and the craps don't freeze.
Yes. So we are down to 30 seconds remaining. Thank you for watching us. Yes, both of you. Thank you, Nicole, for directing. We love you very much. You do a terrific job.
Thank you,
Nicole. Roger, for being here.
As usual, it's been a
yes.
Macabre
Thank
pleasure.
You, Louise, for letting him come and play. And we will see you next week.
Bye-bye.